It's a very perishable skill, what they do. Just a couple of weeks away from it, and you don't have the confidence that you had. It takes you a couple of flights to get back up to speed.
You know, from a flying standpoint, you never get it right. You know, I can't imagine I will ever fly a routine flawlessly and perfectly and come down and say there isn't a single thing I would change about that. And that's what makes it fun for me.
Just because we're just doing this kind of driven in, and then all of a sudden he just dives for it, and I just can't get on the top side of that wing, and then I get behind in the loop.
It's pretty sporty.
Yeah.
The three of the flyers are all perfectionists and obviously very talented pilots, and that shows in the flying, in the performing they do with their airplanes.
I didn't hear a break, so Jimmy's gone, and then you are higher, and then I pull too soon.
Always, always trying to improve. It's all about improvement. And I think that's one of the things that why Dan and Jimmy and I so much enjoy this stuff that we do, besides the huge distraction of it all, is that you can strive for perfection. And when it happens, it's a wonderful experience. But it only happens for little bits and seconds at a time. So when we're up in the three ship and we're doing a barrel roll, and there's just that little magic moment where the aircraft come together.
And it's just the magic that only you touch one or two times in your life. And you live for that moment. It was almost as if you were transparent. Everything just happened. It was easy. There was no anything to it. It just happened, and that's just a magical flight, and you live your life trying to get back to that point.
You have to have a certain mindset. And for me, that mindset includes not accepting being anything shy of perfect at what you're doing. And that can apply to a lot of things in life. And that mindset will make you successful. When you talk about flying aircraft, that mindset's gonna keep you alive.
We wanna fly perfect, and we try to do it, and we push ourselves to do it. But if you're expecting yourself to be perfect, you're gonna be disappointed, because there's no way you can do this. This 99% of the time, you're out of place.
Don't take this the wrong way, but it seemed a little rough.
A little rusty.
Yeah, I think it was rough.
Flying, it's just so three-dimensional. It relies on a machine, a person, the elements. It's always changing, so there's no such thing as perfection.
That'll make it easier. Jimmy goes whack
it's
hard.
It's not about making it easier, it's about me getting it right.
You know, I like setting a goal and figuring out how we can go accomplish the goal and doing it in a way. I mean, none of us want to, we're all obviously risk averse by nature, but the element of risk is an important part of adventure. And that's what excites me. That's what gets me jazzed up about going out and flying, and knowing that we're going to be confronted with all sorts of decisions and how we deal with them is what I think makes it exciting.
You work at it, work at it, work at it, and you get yourself into a rhythm where you do a specific thing. And it's like, okay, here's our routine. We've got our high show, and this is how we're gonna do it. And it's never the way that you thought that it would be.
Wind calm, visibility more than 1-0. Sky condition, ceiling 2,500.
Too low for the vertical stuff. I mean, I'm spending probably an eighth of the loop in the clouds. I'd rather not spend that much time in the clouds.
It's never perfect. It's never smooth. It's never clear in a million. It's always hot. It's always bouncy.
Let's let Jimmy get warmed up.
Noticeably uncomfortable.
Well, I pulled up because I damn near hit a bird. I don't know where it was, but I just didn't like it.
I mean, Dan and I always talk about, it was smooth. I mean, you can sit there and you can just hold the airplane. You can pretty much stay there and look great, but it's just violent.
Did you lose sight of me at all when we got through the clouds? I looked over and saw you guys.
Yeah, I felt good.
I just didn't see the ground.
Yeah. I don't even see them anymore.
Every time you come down, you're never thinking about what went right. You're only thinking about what went wrong.
I think the rejoin was a disaster.
And one of the things that we've probably been working more on as far as energy are our rejoins with this airplane. It has a potentially very high rate of closure because of the speeds, and so it can be deceptive. And as you're out trying to rejoin, you can really come into hell and you don't realize how much extra energy you've got.
It couldn't have been worse than mine.
Yes, it was actually worse, because I almost got an opportunity to hit both of you on separate occasions.
I'm glad I didn't see that.
How much time do we have left to figure this out?
It's quite loud in here. And it's not often that you have a Mustang that has a very good quiet radio that both can broadcast well and can hear well.
Test, test, how do you hear? Last point I'm gonna make, I can't hear anything you're saying, basically.
So we don't hear anything. I have no idea. And then once we start doing all these turns with the clouds, then I have no idea where I am.
I couldn't tell you when I was here whether it were like this or like that. It was really cool. I mean, it was neat, but it was also like—
It's like you're floating?
My brain was thinking, I was like in this, and it was almost like watching it happen. I was like, it's really weird. Like, I can't tell where I am. I was like talking to myself, I was like, I don't know where I am.
Does it make it easier or harder?
It's neither. It's just different.
When you have wingmen that can't understand you, you've got to fly less aggressive and be a little bit more conservative about what you're doing so these guys can have a couple extra seconds to figure out what's going on.
The thing that is humbling about this and the thing that is important as a take-home message is, you know, once you start getting arrogant, cocky, and hubris, that's when things start to fall apart. And maybe you can get away with that in business for a while. Maybe you can get away with that in your relationships. But if you do that in this, you're going to get killed.
You know, they all realize that. They have very successful, very comfortable lives that are extremely safe. Yet somewhere along the line, they got the bug. They started to love flying.
We live in a world of failure with this thing, and we live in a world of fear of failure. At any given moment, one of us could get killed.
When these guys get up there and do their gig, safety is without a doubt the number one concern. All three of those guys, Ed, Jimmy, and Dan, all have the ability to, when they see an unsafe situation, make the right decision and say, King's X, knock it off, we're done. Put the planes back on the ground.
Knowing when something is right and something is not right can be a real simple thing, like a mechanical problem that you just wouldn't go, you know, unless this XYZ is fixed. But for the most part, I think it's a feeling that you get. You just know that it's not right, the time's not right, you should pass on a flight, you should approach it a little bit differently. And I think most of the times when we've raised our hand and said we're not going or something isn't right, it's just a gut feeling that we have about it.
2 and 3, you're out of the formation.
We are involved in operating three high-performance machines, and they are 60-something years old. Now, they've been worked on and they're in excellent shape, but they still are machines. There is that element of risk. And it's not just with the machines. Everybody makes mistakes.
These guys don't know what they don't know. There's something out there that's gonna happen. You know, I have no doubt that they're gonna be able to react to it and overcome it. But there's a lot of unknowns. That's the nature of the beast with airships. And you just have to make sure that you've done everything you can with your training and your preparation and your study and your mental focus to be ready when it hits you. It's never really your time, you're just chosen at the moment.
Nothing. In their view, and when the Spitfires, when he came out wide, he was supposed to be in tight. He came out wide. They went when they were inverted. They saw an airplane, and Ed broke out and said, "That's it."
I was so worked up after that.
Jimmy, I just never recovered from it. I was in tears over it. I thought you guys hit him. I thought it was over. I saw the back of the airplane, and I was like, "What is that?" And I thought it was a Hornet, and I didn't know what to do, and I just airplane straight, and I pulled off to the side, knock it off, and I thought you guys.
You said that, I pulled hard.
Well, then what I thought happened was.
I just said, if I'm gonna die here, I'm gonna die on your wing.
I've never had that feeling. It's like my two best friends in the world. It's like, oh my God, they're gone. I really thought you guys all hit.